With some delay, I would like to start. And I have to admit that it's the first time on a stage that sort of has a red carpet and is a catwalk at the same time. So this is a new thing for me. I have to ask for your understanding, even though I think I'm correctly dressed for a catwalk. But I need this mic to be able to read out the list of names for this afternoon. First of all, I'd like to welcome you very warmly. People from Leipzig, friends, people who've traveled from all over the world and from Europe to join us here. I'd like to welcome you very warmly, but there are a few guests that I'd like to welcome by name. First of all, I'd like to welcome Udo Bullmann, the head of our parliamentary group of the Social Democratic parliamentary group at the European Parliament. Welcome to you. And maybe we will have an opportunity to see you here more frequently over the coming weeks and months, because we do have a challenge ahead of us. Okay, there. Some noise at the background there. Then I'd like to welcome Martin Dulich, the Deputy Prime Minister of the State of Saxony and the Minister of Labour and Economic Affairs, and my boss in his capacity as the State Chairman. And then I'd also like to welcome my colleagues from the European Parliament, Evelyn Gebhardt from Baden-Württemberg, who is the Vice President of the European Parliament. Joachim Schuster from the wonderful city of Bremen, but it's of course not as beautiful as Leipzig. And then Michael Detjen from Rhineland-Palatinate. And I'd also like to welcome very warmly State Secretary Valentina Kerver from the, there you are, I was looking for you, from the Thuringian State Ministry of Economic Affairs, Science and Digital Society. A very warm welcome to you. And then I'd like to welcome representatives from the trade unions, works councillors, and I'm also looking for Ines Kucha. I hope she's here. I haven't seen her, though. Maybe she'll join us a little later. We have lots of guests and representatives from works councils and the trade unions here to join us in the discussion. And I'm also very pleased that we also have representatives from the business sphere here today. And I'd like to welcome, in particular, the chairman of the Saxon Association of Entrepreneurs. So very warm welcome to you. And I'd also, I forgot Holger Mann, I'm sorry. I'm really sorry, Holger Mann. I'd like to welcome you very warmly as well, a member of the Saxon State Parliament and spokesperson in charge of digitalization in Saxony. A very warm welcome to you. I hope I haven't forgotten anyone else. The experts will join us for the fishbowl discussions. Later on, we'll also hear from our Secretary of Justice, Katharina Barley. I'm sure that many of you are looking forward to her statement. Unfortunately, we can't hear the speaker because the mic is off. Speaker off mic, we can't hear the speaker. So the mic is switched on now, and it is sufficiently loud, so everything works perfectly. So I would like to welcome you all very warmly to my hometown. My hometown of Leipzig is one of the most beautiful cities and towns in Leipzig, and in Eastern Germany, it is certainly the Eastern German metropolis. We are one of the few cities in Eastern Germany that are growing, which provides advantages. We have lots of young people here. Last year, the number of births more than offset the number of deaths, which is certainly a good design. Of course, this also brings some challenges because the infrastructure is designed for a city of around 500,000, which is a lot, but we now have a few more than that and we want to continue to grow. So we do have a few challenges for our infrastructure ahead of us. And of course, in view of the discussion as to what happens with the digital world, we have to ask ourselves, do we have sufficient infrastructure or facilities for the digitalization in Leipzig? I think we will hear some examples today, both in the field of industries 4.0 and labor 4.0, where we can actually see what is working well. But we will also see some examples where we do have some challenges. And I believe that digitalization actually, to many people, means that this is something that they're enthusiastic about the opportunities, people you can meet, having your refrigerator do your shopping for you, which is something I would like to have. But then also in the field of automation, we've just returned from the BMW factory where we've seen jobs where we used to have people that needed to do a lot of lifting and movements. And that was really heavy work at one point. And this has now been automated. And protection of human health is better. The work is flawless practically these days. But on the other hand, that also means a change in the world of work. And we'll see some jobs that are lost. We'll see the creation of new jobs. We want to discuss this together with you on this day. Also questions like, do we have qualified staff for that? BMW just told us, the Works Council counselor that we talked to just told us that when the BMW plant was opened in Leipzig, they had 3,000 applicants for every vocational training opportunity they offered, whereas today they still get 300 for every offer they have. And even with the promise of an employment not everyone stays around. So these are challenges that a city also has to face. Looking at the infrastructure, when you come from BMW, you might think of autonomous driving, but that only works if you have sufficient coverage of 5G. If you leave Leipzig and the immediate surroundings of Leipzig, you will notice that sometimes you don't even have internet access, sufficient internet access in the vicinity. The question of whether universities train a sufficient number of young people in that specific field. I think Mr. Weber is going to say a few words on that later on. So in that sense, challenges, yes, definitely there are challenges, but there are also tremendous opportunities. What about society in general? Digitalization is certainly a very controversial topic. Some people are very enthusiastic about it, whereas others feel, ooh, what's going on? I can only operate my old mobile phone. I don't even know a lot about smartphones because I actually only want to use my phone to make phone calls rather than do lots of other things. So there are lots of other people that are concerned about these questions, maybe feeling left out, maybe wondering whether they will still be able to fit into society, and if yes, how to do that. These are questions that we also have to ask. This is an important part where we need to build trust, where we need to show opportunity, especially for older people, that will enable them to really still be part of society. And there's one thing I can tell everyone, including the young people in this room: we will all grow older at some point, and at some point we will all experience those things. And these are the kinds of questions we want to discuss with you today, and maybe we can find some aspects as to what we can do, what we can't do yet. In the European Parliament, in our parliamentary group, we certainly did a lot of work on this last year. We didn't just sit at our desks. We actually did some real work on this last year. So we looked at data protection and the general data protection regulations. I'm sure we'll have some words to say on that. Don't laugh, don't laugh. I've looked at it again, and Andreas Schurich is here. He can certainly say a few words on this. And the General Data Protection Regulation, when we adopted that in the Parliament, when we were involved in the negotiations, we prayed praised for actually being able to do that, because it was a lot of work when that actually was adopted in 2016 with a transition period of 2 years. Everyone seemed to have forgotten about it, and then it arrived, I think it was 20th of May last year, when everyone remembered that they still had 5 days to go before effectiveness, and that's when everyone was so concerned. And then they said, well, the European politicians come up with stuff and nonsense, and we'll have to look into whether that is really true, or because we cover an important aspect of what happens with our data. Do I have a right to my own data? Do I have the right to be forgotten on the internet? And these are the kinds of questions we want to discuss on this day, which is the World Consumer Protection Day. Evelyn Geppert in our parliamentary group stands for consumer protection, and I think in her fishbowl she will have lots of interesting information to share with us as to what we've done and what we still need to be doing in this respect. But there's a lot of work we have to do in the field of cybercrime, and dare I mention it, copyright is also one aspect that we need to look into. And these are certainly aspects that we can discuss today and should discuss today. Hopefully we'll arrive at joint results on this. We will hopefully gain some insights that we can use for the work at the next European Parliament within our parliamentary group. And I'm looking forward to fruitful discussions with you, and I hope that you will enjoy it at least as much as I do, because I'm really enthusiastic for the further development. I would like to bid farewell from this catwalk for now. I'll see you again at the end of this event. Thank you very much.
Fairness. It's a journey celebrating democracy. As the progressive family in Europe, we believe that all our voices need to be heard, more than just casting a vote once every 5 years. Our together journey across Europe started back in 2016, when Europe was shaken to its core. The rise of nationalism and populism became a reality, not only for British citizens, but for millions of Europeans. Since then, we've gathered in public spaces, town halls, and community centers. We are not going to stand by and let Europe be torn apart. We have to fight for our vision of Europe, a society for the many, not the few. That's why we are going local, listening to each other, putting our heads together, and finding concrete solutions. The 2019 European elections will be the most important ever held. But we all need to shape the journey, and not just the end result. Together is our chance to contribute, our chance to make change possible. Together, we are all working for a strong and progressive Europe. Only together we can. And together, we will. It's time to fight for your future. It's time to fight for a fair and social Europe. Let's do that together.
Well, thank you very much, Constanze Krehl, for the kind introduction. Thank you very much to the parliamentary group for this video. And I'd like to use this opportunity to welcome you to our event. My name is Franziska Wilhelm. I'm an author and poetry slammer, and I will accompany you through this day's event. We have lots of interesting experts that we invited for you, familiar with the fields of networking, artificial intelligence, as well as data protection and consumer protection. And we want to use this opportunity to talk to you. And please take this literally. We see this as an opportunity to exchange information and views, and that's also why we'll have the fishbowl discussions. various areas that we've earmarked for that. But before we get started on that, we want to invite one of the hosts of this event. It's the head of the parliamentary group of the SND parliamentary group at the European Parliament, and he will speak to us on sustainable design of digitalization. And I'd like you to welcome him with a round of applause, as we usually do here in Leipzig. So welcome to the catwalk, Udo Bullmann. The only thing missing is a mic, it seems, because we want to be able to hear you, which is, of course, very important. There we are. Here you are. And okay. I don't really like mics, but I'll use one on this occasion. Thank you very much, Francisco. Francisca, thank you very much for your interest in our event. Thank you very much for coming here today. When I saw Constanze here, I really felt relieved that we have already made the list for the European election, because we could have lost you to the fashion industry following your appearance here today. So this is a modern, a fashionable approach we're using here today. Hopefully you like that, but don't be afraid. This is not intended as a lecture-style thing. We want to engage in communication, in a dialogue with you, and that's how we started the day. We looked at one of the most important companies in the region. Absolutely interesting, interesting conversation with the Works Council there. Lots of things I'd like to come back to, but maybe I can start with a chance encounter last night. I arrived here from Düsseldorf. We had a big discussion with trade union representatives there, and I was actually planning to go to the Together Go local reception hosted by the Social Democratic Parliamentary Group, but unfortunately the plane had a problem, so I was stuck in Düsseldorf and arrived late here, so it wasn't really sensible to go to the evening event last night, because that was already about to conclude. So I did what I like to do when I still had a lot of time in my life. I just walked through the town in a city that I'd first seen shortly after the political changes in 89, and then of course I've been back a number of times and always experience the change and to really see it firsthand and experience it firsthand. And I can tell you, last night I was really fascinated by the way Leipzig presented itself, the colorful life that you see in the streets. I was fascinated by the jazz clubs, because this is where I ended up, because often you end up in clubs like that, and the beer was great, and I told the guy at the bar who had a party because it was his birthday, so I can see you all being envious of the great time I had. But so the beer with the Radeberger beer was really good, everything was okay, and then and the band was great. It was live music, and there was just one idea I had. I thought, my God, isn't that Constanze? Leipzig is the city of heroes, but is this Leipzig not also an indication, a symbol of the East rising? A sign showing you that the people in the East can rise again, and that the promises can come true after all this time. Finally, after the promises that Helmut Kohl, regardless of his merits, but these promises may have been a bit premature at the time, promising the flourishing landscapes in Eastern Germany that could not be financed at the time. But maybe this is the time. Maybe we can use this opportunity to use the experience that this wonderful, dynamic, bright city has gathered. Maybe we can use this as a sign of courage. Maybe we can turn over a new leaf for all of Eastern Germany. Maybe we need to turn over a new leaf, showing people that they can have a say, that they can be politically active, that they can work here, and that they can deal with the issues of today, and that this does not necessarily have to lead to fear or worry, but provides an opportunity for having a better tomorrow than today is and yesterday was. That is an old social democratic motto, making tomorrow better than today is and yesterday was, and we all are trying to do that. Let me now come back to the story that we shared at BMW today. Yes, 4.0 has arrived. Yes, we've heard the Works Council working at the various BMW establishments where in various fields of production, various modernization strategies are being implemented to ensure that the best possible experience is gathered and then rolled out at all the different sites. We've also heard that new technology really is a blessing, and we've seen that jobs that used to be dirty and dangerous and difficult and jeopardized workers' health because they had to work with paints and varnishes, and then where cars were fueled, all of these things are done and controlled via computer today. Yes, the bottom line will be that some of these jobs will be lost, other jobs will be created, but it appears likely that, that's what the gentleman from BMW has told us, in a 1-to-20 ratio, so for one new creative job opportunity where a programmer can find a job feeding data into the computer, doing the framing, defining the mindset of the technical intelligence, but for that one person, 20 other colleagues will lose their job or will have to move to other industries. So society in general will become richer because, as in all leaps of technology, we will be able to produce more with less human effort. But what do we do with that wealth that we create? Who will get that wealth? Who will benefit from that wealth? And these are the kinds of questions that rise in this context. What happens to one of the most important aspects that we have in modern society? Time sovereignty. So many people will say, yes, it will become easier with the new technology. It will make it easier to combine raising a family and having a job, not just for women, but also for men. But being in charge, being the master of your own time also means that you can adjust more flexibly to times where you have to take care of children or of your parents. But who is the master of that time? Who decides at the end of the day who will benefit from that newly gained freedom and flexibility? It's good. It's certainly we could work from home if you want to, but who of you wants to have the mobile phone at home all the time until your boss calls you to that you have to work right away? Who wants that? No one wants that, because that form of mastering of being a master of your time basically means losing freedom rather than gaining freedom. And the works counselor at BMW gave one very poignant example of that. He talked about his own family and said that his wife told him he was not allowed to use the plant mobile phone at home, and while on holiday, she even told him, either your mobile phone or I will leave. And he said he took the right decision on that question. We congratulated him on that. But that really, joking aside, this is really something that reflects the reality of many people. They work a lot, they work all the time, and will work even more in future. So the question is, who is the master of that newly created wealth? And that is a very fundamental question. The works counselor told us his people are really enthusiastic about technology. They like that. They want to deal with that. They like that challenge. But none of them wants to lose their job because of that. And if the people who program those things, in the warehouse, we now need 6 people less per shift. They don't have to do that hard work, hauling around boxes and crates, and there are tons of weight that they move throughout one working day, then the Works Council can tell them, well, if they have to go to the construction site to haul around bags of cement, then they will even have to carry more per shift. So that is a question that we need to look into. Will we win at the end of this process, or will we as employees lose at the end of the day? So that newly gained freedom, Constance is very familiar with that, means that at the end of the day, we are no longer tied to certain sites. We could make those regions rich that feel left out right now. Especially in Eastern Germany, we know what that means if a region feels left behind. First thing to break down is the economy, then infrastructure, and then at some point people no longer believe that they are part of society, and then we end up with problems that we don't want to have, namely of populists that tell you that nationalism and hatred is the answer to our problems, and they certainly aren't. But will that be the case at the end of the day? Will those regions benefit that were left behind under the last condition of the economy, or should we, or will we see even more concentration on large cities where innovations take place first? And that really also shows us the approach to how do we deal with technology, and how can technology be distributed to even the smallest villages and municipalities? That is a question for politics. These are politics that are important for people, and we should not disregard these questions. And then at the end of the day, what does the work look like that we're talking about? And who owns the wealth that is created through this work? Is the situation, as the Works Council at BMW said, well, the capitalists only invest if it pays off for them, and they then want to keep the profits to themselves. Now, does that mean that the huge profits that are generated by making technology ever more modern will be concentrated in the hands of the few, and that on the other hand we have a kind of new slave labor platform workers that have no rights, that are called to be told when they have to show up for work, how they have to work? And I could tell you lots of things about our fight in the European Parliament, doing what our ancestors did, namely defending the proper working day, a proper working day where there are no zero-time contracts. This one of the biggest achievements was defined by Marx as one of the most important steps in the labor movement, namely the fight for regulated working hours to make clear that the rest of the day belongs to the respective worker, and you're no longer subject to instructions for the person who happens to be your boss or your superior. But that seems to be happening over again. And all of the questions that we're discussing in this respect are questions that we're familiar with. Are taxes still being paid by the big digital corporations? This week, an attempt failed at a European level by the French to introduce the digital tax. And that's also why we have to use this platform wherever we meet to say this can't be the last word on that. Those who use the new data machines generating profits from that also need to make a contribution to society. They need to pay taxes like everyone else does. We in the European Parliament, the Social Democratic Parliamentary Group, certainly is going to fight for that, and we can assure you of that. This is one of our promises for this legislature as well as for the next. All the other questions. All the other questions that we are discussing basically can be summarized using one image. If we look back at the history of Germany and at the history of European societies, then yes, technological change is something that we've often seen, the wave of industrialization in the late 19th century, the early 20th century. This all involved lots of change and distortions as well, not only in the form of labor organization, but also in people's self-perception, in the political culture, in the culture of work. You gained something and you lost something. These were profound changes when craftsmen realized that they would become workers in large factories. But digitalization is even more profound profound, and it's faster than that. So we're not only talking about labor organizational change, but also about change in social organization. There will be anger, there will be disappointment, there will be concerns, there will be worries. And we see a lot of that today in right-wing populism and extremism in many countries. And that brings me to one of the core ideas of this event today, the social and democratic idea. Wherever you see that, wherever you see it doing its work, is never just passively taken note of these things. We didn't just want to let these things happen. We were never the ones who said, stop new technologies. And we never said, just, you know, give them room, they will do whatever they want. We always felt that we needed to design it, to shape it. We need to give it a human face. We need to design it at the workplace. We need to help and design it through trade union involvement, to shape it through political work to make sure people benefit from it rather than suffer under it. So we don't want it to lead to new fears. We want it to lead to hope, to opportunities, and to enrich people's lives. And we need the German social democratic movement for that. We need the European social democratic movement for that. And we need social democracy in Thuringia, in Saxony, in all Eastern German states. And we need to make a massive contribution to that through our dialogue. And this is also the aim of the event today. We've already shown that in the past, but we'll need to do it over again to be successful in future. Thank you very much for your interest. I'm very much looking forward to the event now. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank Ute Bullmann for these introductory words. And with regard to the European Parliament, we will now come back to Saxony, to the exciting world of startups, especially when their startups are on the way. Digitalization and networking play a very important role. We have invited someone who has already accompanied many startups from the Spinlet Lab company. He is director of the Smart Infrastructure Hub in Leipzig, and he will explain his work. We would like to welcome Eric Weber. Welcome. I'm pleased to be here today and to introduce my project. I would like to invite you to Leipzig when you are so excited about the town in winter. You should come back in summer as well. So we will also see a very interesting change that has the city underwent with regard to lignite coal use. This is still a topic, but we had a lot of changes. Mr. Dulich will also do a lot of things about this topic of climate change and energy. But you can see that the former brownfields are now flooded, and this is now a large recreation area of lakes. This is also something to do with our project, that the changes of infrastructure, especially in the field of energy, smart city regions, and e-health as well. We have developed a project which is mainly financed by companies. That means the commitment of the companies is visible here to be flexible and also to have to provide solutions for these questions the society bothers. And I would like to see now to the screen. I hope that next year we will work on the project that allows us to transform Leipzig into a very important hub for the digital transformation. And the initiative originates from 2015, where at that time Sigmar Gabriel had the idea, and he noticed at that time that we on European level, or also on the worldwide context, we are a little lagging behind the digitalization of the state of the art. And this is not a question if we want to do this, or we the Germans or Europeans want to do this, but we have to see it in a global context. So we don't have any influence on certain technology developments or platforms that develop at the world. One of the initiatives you mentioned is a digital tax. In Bavaria, the tax authorities started to levy a tax for the last 15 years for all the income that they earned by advertising. And they studied all these incomes, and they point out that they can get back this tax from Google and Facebook by the companies on their own. But I wonder how companies should do this with Google and Facebook if our government doesn't manage to get the taxes from them. How can a small startup do this that we support? And nevertheless, they started in order to build up these 12 digital highlights here in Germany, and they want to strengthen these hubs and also focus and enlarge in the future. But unfortunately, it's only one of four projects of the coalition project that have already been implemented under the Start on Track. But there is still some work to do in this field. And these 12 sites have been elected in a competition, and to promote them for their future work. So at that time, we thought that this would be a good thing for Leipzig. Fits very well to this digital city, a city that is growing, and we have to participate. And so we thought about which are the areas where we have already had a good success in this field. So that which are the industries where we have strong and solid companies, where are the startups situated, and where we have research that is on an international level. On the one world, on the one hand, we have the corporate world. We have we are a town or a city of 600,000 inhabitants, and 100,000 people work in these different fields. This also includes the health system. Helios hospitals are also a very important part of this, and every 10th of the inhabitants are working in this field. There are other areas such as logistics, energy, IT, economics, or industry, which have developed very quickly. And on the other hand, we are also a very promoted or strong startup place. I often ask the Chamber of Commerce how much of them are here. We think that approximately 200 to 250 of these companies are to be counted as startups. We have 25 co-working spaces, accelerator laboratories, and for the different fields of the industry that help them. On the other hand, we have research projects. We also have several universities strongly supported by different fields, and they have a project budget of approximately 200 million euros here in Leipzig and can use it for research purposes. But we would like to combine these three areas in a better way. They exist already, but there is something that has to be changed. They exist in parallel, and there is not yet enough connection in between. And we want to get them together by providing the infrastructure for this, also including authorities and politics, administration. We need a customer protection system, and that means all the questions have to be clarified with regard to this, and that's why it's very important for us to talk about these things and to find pragmatic solutions to these issues. And I think that pragmatism is a very important word here, and this is also a thing to provide a quick decision. I would like to talk about four partial projects in this field. The one project is called the SpinLab Accelerator. I was a co-founder of 4 years ago. It was a project between Leipziger Baumwollspinnerei Company and private universities for economics. They started this, and we support the startups for a period of half a year about the topics of market introduction and financing. And so we have laid out this on in the fields of energy, smart city, and e-health. And these are areas that have a double effect. activities are, on the one hand, development of the economy, but also very important for the society. All the investments made in these fields will come back to the society at the end. A second big project we are still working on, hopefully until the end of the year, this is the extension of services. Leipzig is a booming town. We need we see that Leipzig is the most attractive market for office spaces, and we are about to build new offices on 5,500 square meters of office spaces. Moreover, we are active in the field of other industries, and we want to enlarge all these projects. Last point I would like to say something about, and this is something that is very important to me personally. Not all the projects can be carried out via subsidy or financing, but we also need private finance. We need companies, entrepreneurs, we need investors that believe in their ideas and also provide financing and have a certain motivation that help those people to bring their products to market perfection. And in Europe, we invest only a fourth of the amount of investment in this sector industry. And so in Saxony, we still can make up for these amounts to be invested. And Saxony and Thuringia and Saxony-Anhalt, which are regarded as central Germany, we can calculate these numbers for these three regions. And the sum of venture capital is only 2% with regard to the Berlin-based investment capital. And in Germany, it's only, fourth of the European possibilities. Now, there will be some more problems when London has its trouble with the Brexit. We are about to have the first venture capital fund that will be founded here in Germany for the first time. And after 1.5 years, I know why it is the first one, because it is not so easy to set up such a fund. Also, the structures of assets are very important to be taken into account and other things. So this is a very important topic, which should not be underestimated when talking about startups and such development. These were the most important points about this. I'm very pleased that we can discuss about this in the fishbowls about artificial intelligence. And I'm very pleased I'm excited to have this discussion later on. Thank you very much.
Wie wir miteinander kommunizieren, wie wir
Digitalization is in advance. It decides how we can change our life and configure our leisure time. In our Europe of the future, managing tablet computer and other computers are not a question of age or money. Digital education will be an integral part for jobs, school and universities. Having common rules, it is necessary to create fair working conditions, especially for these new working environments. We must have the right to decide on our own what our data are used for. Private things should remain private for the future too. The social media are matters of our own, and the consumer protection is one thing that is always very much appreciated. And we always have to provide a updated software to manage our data. It's a fair thing when everybody will get a break. There will be a right in our Europe of being not or of being unavailable in certain times. We have to think about our future life, how we want to live together in the future, digitally and fair, our vision for a Europe of the future. Okay, I would like to say once again thank you to Eric Weber from Infrastructure Hub of in Leipzig, we saw that digitalization does not only move startups and the economy, but also our everyday life and the social life. The question is, how can we manage to combine all these different items together with other needs, for instance, the need for social justice, private sphere, and all these things? And I would like to welcome somebody who can say something about this, because he has not only a very exacting job, but also a big family, and he has to manage all this. And he is also the deputy minister president of Saxony and the chairman of the SPD parliamentary group in Saxony. Martin Dulich, welcome. Once again, I would like to welcome you here to Leipzig, to Saxony. The day before yesterday, there was the publication of the Digitalization Index, and Saxony was on the first rank. And the Digitalization Index shows how far the wide frequency internet has been established, and other digital strategies are described that have to be taken into account. And moreover, now, is it a reason to celebrate? I can say that we were pleased about this first. This is necessary. But we are also proud of what we could do during the last 5 years, what we could start and initiate in these years with regard to the extension of the internet. We had a fund of 700 million, and we are able now to discharge the communities from their own contribution. And now it should be possible to provide glass fiber networks to all the different villages. And we hope that we can manage this until 2026. But I'm still a little reticent. The index of digitalization is something very good. But if we ask the people, did it arrive in your village as well? People tell us, or will answer us, today it wasn't possible to use the telephone between Leipzig and Dresden, and the internet use is also not yet optimum. And so you should be careful with such figures. They describe a certain dynamics, but the question will be what concretely or what exactly will arrive at the people. When we talk about this digitalization, about a successful thing in society, we have to ask, what is the scale to measure the progress? Is it something like the surface covering installation of glass fiber, or is it the mobile phone network, or is it the 5G system what matters? So we have to take care not to reduce our discussion down to such topics only. When talking about digitalization, this is a normal thing, a banal thing to know. Digitalization will change all the fields of life, and that the things that are used or with the wide band internet is only one part, but we are talking about much more questions of these changes, not only about the technology we use. And that's why we can be pleased that we are a dynamic country or region, dynamic region. And Mr. Weber also expressly said that when we have the support of two hubs, there is one in Leipzig, another one in Dresden, and we are part of this network, not only in Germany, but on international level. We are also very pleased that we could now establish a software institution in Leipzig, that we have very good preconditions here, apart from the hardware or technology, because in Saxony, we are the fourth producer by size of microelectronic components, such as Infineon and other companies. And on the other hand, we have also a growing industry of software production. We can be pleased, but we also have to look on international level countries, and if we compare, we should be a little more humble here, and to take efforts to start that. But I think that first part here, we lost quite a lot because Asia was wide ahead. And how can we as a European region manage not only to make up for the things we lost by now, but also to get again a technological leadership in this field? And here we should not only think on the Saxon level and think that we have the good preconditions and we will be the big bosses then, but we have to think it on an European level. And I think that the future will be the European platform systems. For instance, we as the Saxon Parliament work together with different regions in Europe. We have been to northern part of Trabant in the Netherlands, and we found out that we all have the same questions. We work on the same topics using same approaches and instruments, and try to invent the wheel several times here in Europe. Why do we do this? Why don't we want to look to the other regions to find cooperation platforms in the field of research and others in order to exchange our experience, because they work on the same topics? And Europe gives us a precondition, a good precondition to do this. And the question is, what is actually successful? What does it mean? There is a saying that everything that can be digitalized will be digitalized. We heard this in the 70s as well. Everything that could be automized should be automized at the time. At that time, it was connected with a discussion about the factory where no human human being will work any longer. Now the question is, when we digitalize everything that is possible, will it also bring empty spaces of factory? But I don't think that will be, at least not during the coming 20 years, because the work changes the world. But when we talk about this digitalization with regard to our own company, it is not only about how to become more innovative as a company. We also have to take into account the fact that we can only be successful if we change our mind by thinking differently, when our society can think of the changes that may happen in the coming 50 years and to think about how the society will look like in the coming 50 years in order to derive from the challenges that will await us what we have to do, because otherwise we will get into a backlog because we only develop or optimize things. But we have to think about how our society can be accompanied during the coming 50 years in this field, because we also have another problem. There are the one people, for instance, they are very excited about digitalization because they see all the technical possibilities and they can describe all the things that will be possible in the future. Robotic machines will replace different kinds of jobs or work, and how it can be at home as you can facilitate your home. But there are other people, they say, I'm very afraid about this. What about me? What about my person? Can I come up to the expectations then? And people also ask about their jobs, what will be in the future. And this discussion about digitalization has not only a political or development aspect, but also has a function with regard to society. And this is especially a task of social democrats to take into account the society when talking about these technological things, to ask what will happen with the people and what is necessary to establish in order to provide people good jobs for the future too. Work will change completely. But as to my person, I'm part of those who think that there are certain areas which will be stronger due to digitalization, although they are not directly connected with it. I think, for example, that the social work will have a higher importance in the future. There will be areas where it will become more important, where people work with people, and it's not about the question of replacing some jobs by digitalization or robots. This may be different in Japan. In Japan, they are talking about these things because they have advanced more in the field of robotics. But the question of whether the interaction between human beings can be replaced by this, I can't imagine, at least not in the years to come. I can imagine that there may be nursery robots that help you, for instance, lifting heavy loads, but not a replacement for a nurse. I think that one future point will be that the social work will be strengthened in the future. I also think that in certain fields of craft, they will set great store by a creative work, they deliberately will decide not to take the products produced by the 3D printer, but to take a crafts product, which is about creativity. And these jobs will also have a future, but the biggest part, our trade work and the production, will change very much. And that's why our challenge that we have to tackle is the education and qualification. That means the big challenge will be how we can enable people to work with these new technologies, with digitalization, in order to strengthen their own workforces. And this will be the big key, the question of education, training, qualification of people in order to come up to these requirements and to have a chance and not to see only the risks. And I see that this is our big European task that we have to tackle, not only in Asia. The first half of the period was won. We can see that in the United States they made advances that are more advanced than we have, and that's why we need a European endeavor in order to get at arm's length to play or to be at the same level to compete with them. So when once digitalization is carried out successfully and on a social basis, the answer will be Europe.
Thank you very much, Martin Dulich, for this summarizing statement that also formed an introduction to the next item on our agenda. We are now come to the interactive part of our event, the fishbowl discussions. Fishbowl in that case not meaning that you have to go and watch what's going on in an aquarium from the outside. No, we invite you to join us in this fishbowl and join the discussion. We now have four parallel discussion sessions. I'll briefly take you through these discussions. Round A is entitled Making Different Better. How do we design the world of work of future? Again, platform work and the question of how do we maintain social standards. That is certainly filled with experts. Irina Rudolph Kockert, a member of the think tank for employees questions, and in Leipzig she's also known for her political activities in the city. Then we have Holger Mann, member of the Saxon State Parliament and spokesperson of his parliamentary group on universities and digitalization. Joachim Schuster, member of the European Parliament, and of course those of you who want to join them in that discussion. Where will round A meet? Session A will be over there. You see these small chairs there. So if you feel that work, the world of work and the future is interesting for you, then that's your session. Then session B is entitled Smart Use of Opportunities. How can we prepare companies for networking and artificial intelligence, involving questions of the ethics involved in AI? And this group will comprise Valentina Kirst. We'd already heard her being welcomed by Constanze Krehl at the beginning of our event. She's the State Secretary at the Thuringian Ministry of Economic Affairs and Digitalization, and she's a long-standing expert in digitalization. We have Michael Detjen, who's a member of the European Parliament and a member of the Committee of Social Affairs and Labour. Then Christoph Trümmler, who's the head doctor at a hospital in Leipzig and a professor of e-health at Edinburgh Napier University. E-health standing for digital healthcare, and Eric Weber, who we've already met from the SpinLab startup. And then, of course, you can also be part of that session. Where will session B on networking and AI meet? That will be at the front of the hall. And then session C is entitled Update Required, Network Products and Online Platforms Change Our Day-to-Day Life. How do we ensure consumer protection? The keywords here being transparency of online platforms and market platforms and transparency of comparison portals. We all know that products are ranked and no one really knows how transparent that process is. And that group will comprise Evelyn Gebhardt, Vice President of the European Parliament, and one of her main main topics is consumer protection, and then Ottmar Lell, who is from the Federal Association of Consumer Protection Agencies in Germany and the head of the Legal and Trading Department. And of course, you are also welcome to join then, and session C will meet at the back of the hall, and then the last corner of this hall, last but not least, is entitled Hackers, Trackers, Data data Collectors. Which level of data protection do we want, comprising the chairman of the data protection agency in Saxony, then the representative in charge of the GDPR, then Constanze Krehl, who you've already seen on stage earlier on, and Andreas Schurich, who's not only a mathematician and theologist by training, but also the data protection officer of the state of Saxony. And this round will be web streamed into English. We need a lot of transparency here as well. I just like to sort out those sessions. So session A, World of Work, is over there. Then AI and networking is over there. Consumer protection is over there. Yeah, that was it. And then data protection over there. You now have 35 minutes for that discussion. And we'll meet again at 6 o'clock. And I'm really looking forward to the reports you can give us at that point. Thank you very much.
I see that there is somebody sitting there, and I say that those who talks has to take a microphone, because this fishbowl will be translated and will also be web streamed and translated into the English language. So I would like to start. Oh, what? It's not so good, somebody said. So I would like to start. This sound will only be transmitted to the interpreters, or for instance, our Mrs. Ambassador will hear it in English now, and this is good. I heard that we are now in a fishbowl that is streamed. I think that has been informed in the invitation, because we stick to the data privacy regulation, and we are enforced to do this, but you bring me to the topic that I wanted to discuss with you.
And this is something I mentioned up on the catwalk. GDPR is certainly a very important milestone in the European Union, and the fact that we've managed to achieve that. Personally, I wasn't really very much involved in that legislation, but colleagues from our group were, of course, more involved in that. And then they told me that there was a tremendous level of lobbying from all sorts of conceivable and inconceivable sides involved. What we ultimately presented and negotiated with the member states, I think, is something that is worthwhile. But it was adopted in 2016 with the result of the negotiation with the member states. And then we had a 2-year transition period to make sure that everyone, and I repeat, everyone, could prepare for that new regulation. And then May last year arrived, and all of a sudden everyone was astonished, shouting out, those in Brussels, that was complete stuff and nonsense, and now we all have to prepare for that, and all the clubs and associations in Germany will go down, and the small companies will go bankrupt. Andreas, how much truth is there in that, and what's the reality today? Well, it certainly was a big effort that was undertaken. And I think that in large parts it is very positive. Yes, of course, there were some developments that could be improved. That's always the case. When you do something and then implement it into practice, then amendments are often necessary. And you rightly said there was an outcry when the legislator in Germany, for example, let a lot of time pass before adopting the necessary legislation. That was the national adaptations, and that was very much at short notice. So that left little time to prepare for that. So it was certainly significantly less than 2 years. And as a result of that, even though I personally had the impression that, yes, it kept coming up every now and then, lots of people were astonished and surprised by that. So the lobbying associations really failed in this, because they're not only intended to do lobbying work, they should also support their members. And obviously that was not done to the required degree. So there was an outcry that you just mentioned, even though I feel that looking at the topics that were discussed, and there were lots of fake news, I have to say, lots of alleged news that were not true at all, and that gave you the impression that some people actually tried to belittle this, and they picked out extreme examples to use this to illustrate a point. We received all sorts of inquiries from sports associations that felt they'd have to do all sorts of things. Then there were stories about redacted texts in kindergarten, or that parents were no longer allowed to take pictures in kindergarten events. And these are subjects that you can handle that. But it's now been roughly a year since it took effect, and things have quietened down a little. And what I now see is that we get significantly more inquiries from the public than before. So we do see that people are more aware of this, but this also holds true for companies. A number of companies actually have taken that opportunity to look at what they do with data, how they process data in their companies. We get lots more damage reports from companies that contact us, telling us, something must have gone wrong, and we are trying to sort it out. So in that sense, I think we can draw a positive conclusion so far, looking at the companies, small and medium-sized companies at a national level that are doing that. They still have a long way to go, but we're on the right track. And I have to say that, of course, the equipment of our supervisory authorities is not up to what actually needs to be done, but that's a different issue. I'm not going to focus on that in too much detail. One aspect that I'd also like to mention, we talk about those big companies collecting data, the big corporations. And actually, they were part of the focus of the GDPR, and we do see problems there because we have a European mechanism trying to handle those corporations, and that mechanism is slowly evolving, and there are issues because we find that all the supervisory authorities in Europe, all the competent supervisory authorities, need to actively approach the companies, putting pressure on them. If that doesn't happen, there might be problems. There's a regulation mechanism for that in GDPR that might have to be revised, though. And the second aspect is, and we have people from the consumer protection agencies here today, when we have court hearings with those big corporations, you have to expect those proceedings to extend over 5 to 6 years through the various instances until you have a final ruling. If you compare that with the technical development, you have situations where the actual matter has become obsolete before the trial is resolved. And my impression is that at least some of the big corporations are consciously trying to use this and just adopt a wait-and-see approach by initiating legal proceedings, then taking it to the next level. And that actually shows that this control, this attempt to exert influence and to actually enforce those rights towards the large corporations with the approach of becoming actively after things have happened, so taking those corporations to court, implementing supervision measures, that might be too late in that process. So I would rather have the good approaches, privacy by design, privacy by default, being implemented in general without too much bureaucracy, similar to the situation which we have in antitrust legislation, where we also have the opportunity to actually have a say in the form of a permit for corporate mergers, for example. And maybe that would be an approach that could be followed further. Okay, I'd like to hand over to the representative from the Consumer Protection Agency. What is the actual situation with regard to this? First of all, I would like to really compliment the political sector on this because we were able to actually go to Facebook. We got a legal address that we could serve an action to, and that is actually what happened. So this is something you can do, and this is something we have done. And there are two aspects to this. Consumer protection agencies are often concerned as those who want to ruin the fun and spoil the party, but when you try to describe the problem, you end up explaining it. And Mr. Schurich was right when he said and earlier on in the process would be more convenient. So it would be optimum to have a company building in consumer protection right from the outset. Let me use Facebook as an example because we actually all have a problem. Consumer protection agencies want to become younger, more dynamic. What do? We do establish what we do in Facebook presence, but the European court decided, well, actually you can't really have that because you have liability for that, but it can't be liable for that because Facebook doesn't give me an opportunity to. Otherwise, I would have to have the possibility to influence the business model. So that's why we're suing right now. So one issue is those really, really big corporations, and that's also part of the system behind that. And Europe is having a difficult time dealing with that. You said that we need to look at the big corporations. We tried to establish a digital tax. I think we failed because your state was against it. So there are lots of interests that need to be balanced in this process. And what I like to see is when we talk about data protection, let's not talk about how difficult it is and how bad everything is. Let's use the example of Robert Habert, That keeps coming up in crisis, when you see what are the advantages of that? What is the protection that we get? What does the EU GDPR do by way of improvement for us? And amendments will also add to that. We need to use different wording in what we say. EU GDPR, that is an awful word. It gives me spots, to be honest. So basically, it should be called our rights of freedom are defended. And that is something that is much more catchy, and everyone would understand what's behind that. If you hear a presentation on data protection legislation, it kind of makes you want to go to sleep. Maybe we should bring in young people from a nerdy computer club that tell everyone why it's so important to protect our data. Where are the young people in all of this? I look at them provocatively now. So young people who say, I don't only want to operate the device, I want to be sure that I can be secure, privacy by default, privacy by design. Again, difficult words. Maybe we could have some catchwords like saying this mobile phone is safe and you can operate it without any concerns. And this is the kind of terminology we should use. So, and we need consumers to be part of that. And that brings me to the last point. I'd like to mention media education. Media education is certainly of the utmost importance, not only in the sense of just taking a mobile phone, operating it. Like if I told my daughter not Instagram, I would probably lose custody of her. She's much faster with her thumb than I am with 10 fingers on that device. But still, I have to discuss Section 13 with her. I have to discuss about the internet with her. I have to discuss copyright with her. And that makes it fascinating. And if you make things fascinating, people become interested. And then you also get that message across and make things safe as well as social. Applause is, of course, always welcome. I have a question for the Consumer Protection Agency representative. As you can see, I'm no longer the very young generation, and certainly to comply with my professional honor as a computer scientist, I try to keep up with the new technologies as best as possible. Of course, I was very dedicated in pushing through the data protection regulation, always defended that without doubt. But what we're seeing today, in my opinion, is that I need to agree all the time as to whether I want to provide my data, how much of my data I want to provide, which is, of course, okay in general. And it's just a small step saying, okay, you may use that data, you can't have that data. But what I find irritating is when I download a new app onto my smartphone, and the app then asks me, I want to access the photographs, the calendar, and I say, no, this app doesn't really need my photographs, it doesn't need my calendar. And if I say no, then unfortunately, I can't even use that app, even though I would like to use it. Then how can we find rules for that? I have a right to use apps that are provided for use, without the obligation to provide data that this app does not need, and that is none of its business. Hello, first of all. The phone is, the mic is on. I come from the side of the software developers. I work in this field in business in Leipzig. And regarding the issue of the app you mentioned, internally we call that a nerd meeting or therapy for grown-ups. So I found a way of bringing together experts, and we always meet at Kaiserbad in Leipzig and also discuss those issues. And we've developed the idea of increasing the sense of responsibility in producing those apps. So if I develop an app, it's my right to say, this is a function I need for this app, and this is a function I don't need for this app. But I need to be able to explain to you as the user why I need this specific function in a transparent and easy to understand format. Do we agree on that? Yeah. So, and our idea was to have something like general terms and conditions, a window that would pop up and that establishes a link between the clearance that is required and the information of why that is needed, and then you can agree to it or you can choose not to agree to it. This is a concept we've developed and that we also implement. Maybe I can come back to Ms. Craig, maybe also in addition to your first question. Again, let's be honest. You have such a window where it says, do you agree? Do you really want to agree? Do you really, really want to agree? If you click on this, you have agreed. And when you surf the internet, one day you've clicked 75 of those buttons. You need more structure for that. I find it completely irritating if I need to call in a technician to be able to make sure that the clock works on my iPad. Can we prevent that situation? Yes, you can do that by establishing clear rules for the big corporations, and we still have a lot of need for that. Where are the authorities that also establish provisions regarding the default settings, not only regarding the right to use the date, but also the default settings? And my second question is, why is that so boring? Every app developer develops wonderful things to get people using their apps and deterrence to get rid of data protection. You know, if you specify what you do to make sure that that person doesn't come to any harm, then that might be a different outlook altogether. So, because you come from that industry, I'd like to encourage you to adopt a more playful attitude to that. And I try to preach in favor of a pragmatic approach. Your job is to inform the users about the importance of data protection, and it's the user's obligation to request that from people like myself. It's part of our standard. We build that into our products. There is no discussion about that, because at the end of the day, I'm also a private person, and I would certainly not like seeing the data that Instagram and Facebook organizes about myself and what quality that has. And you certainly are familiar with that too. So yeah, there was a question for me. Just a second. I'm the host here. I'm sorry, and that's why I have regained control of the mic at this point. You'll have your say in a second. It is just one question I'd like to come back to, and I think we should discuss this question, is how many legal regulations do we need? Or as a German, that what immediately springs to mind is bureaucracy. If we have even more rules, does that make things easier? Or should we simply do things? And now you can answer that question. Maybe that fits in with this, because you said that you want to have general terms and conditions that are more understandable for the users. And I believe that this is something that is not very likely, because most companies are not really interested in a very high level of data protection for the users. And then the question I have is, maybe isn't that also part of the scope of GDPR, making this mandatory? If you don't have that, you don't have to read 50 pages with lots of sections that you don't understand before signing such an agreement. So maybe we can establish the requirement to have 5 or 6 bullet points that outline why that data is collected, why it's needed. I can just give you an example without naming names, of course. I processed a market research project together with a business consultancy that Roland Berger, and that focused on the question of how far can we go in monitoring individuals in Instagram. One point for you, on Instagram, never tag locations, and you should never, in the interest of yourself and your friends, you should never tag people in those pictures, because that will automatically turn you into a person made of glass. We worked with a very big company from Germany that do that in their work. And we had a very confidential meeting. We talked about patterns, and they immediately shut us down on that one. It's different with smaller or medium-sized companies. We received inquiries from medium-sized companies, and I directly respond to that. I got one inquiry asking me, "Dear Johannes, I have one person who applied to us for a job. He introduced himself as a vegan person who never drinks alcohol. Please check whether that is really true." And I always try to rely on the logics of your work. We hope to see a situation where the political sector doesn't say, "Oh, we don't really want more bureaucracy." What is interesting and important is that line of argumentation saying this is unethical. It's unethical for companies to get that data from somewhere, saving that data, using that data to look at whether a new employee has a sound sleep pattern. And we clearly have to show them that this is unethical, this is not something you do. Well, it's easy to say that, but at the end of the day, you have to understand that data like that are checked with algorithms, and as a result, people are being manipulated. Few people are aware of that. And many people, on the other hand, needed to be able to do their work adequately. So where do we start that ethics discussion, and where do we need very clear rules of the game? And maybe you let me finish first, please. There are two further requests to be heard, or we can perhaps pass on the mic.
Is definitely unethical, but the question is, are we willing to pay for the services we now get for our data, actually? Because it's nothing that we get for free. We get stuff like Facebook or any other apps that are for free in exchange of our data. So are we able to pay, or are we able to develop more sustainable business models that will respond to our needs? And also a bit financially sustainable without using our data.
Can you give the micro direct to your neighbor and then...
Maybe a scene from the perspective of a big German corporation. Yes, it has led to increased awareness, also to an aware use of data. The second aspect, when GDPR was implemented, I checked out the website of the German Data Protection Officer to see what are the 10 steps that we now have to take. And then I was told, or I gathered from that website, and that was 2 weeks before the due date, that this website would soon publish manuals outlining the tasks of the 16 data protection officers of the individual states and the federal data protection officer. Then I went to the website of the British data protection officer and checked out the 10 points for privacy, downloaded that, and was roughly informed on what I had to do. So if we think about authorities and about tools and instruments, we also need to take a good look at ourselves, at how we advise and how do we support, rather than building and adding layers of supervision. And one aspect that also ties in with your question, how do we deal with the fact that they earn money with these data? So again, where do we have market mechanism? That ties into your question, Constanze. We always think that we need to check things before they happen. Of course, there's also the model of damage liability, where we also check risks. We might think of external trust providers, because we don't want to have controls from the outset. Otherwise, we wouldn't have to invite Eric Weber, because we have the spin lab, because we want to have those corporations not only in the USA, but also in Europe, because they also create value and add value. So we need to think about more than just upfront control. And I'd like to know what you think about this, because more control just means that we've controlled everything, but it will certainly prevent those future and forward-looking jobs from moving to Europe.
I would like to give the opportunity to Melanie to speak. I think this was a very important point you mentioned, Constanze. The question is, if we are not, if we do not agree with giving free our data, otherwise we can't use the application. The problem today is that the apps mainly are free of charge, but free of charge is not actually free of charge. That means they cost no money, but we understood that data is like the new oil of our new time, and that we have to react on these new developments. And when we would like to think throughout the different panels, we have the consumer protection panel over there, and we will have new regulations coming from Brussels. There will be a new guideline from that will be enacted in March in Brussels, and they will say that if something is had for nothing, but I have to give my data for it, this won't be seen as free of charge, because this is also like a currency. So in such case, I also need to have certain guarantee rights when paying by data. And I think there will be new approaches in coming from Brussels, that we pay with a different currency, and this will also explain to us why you can't access the app, or when you don't release the photographs or others, because there was somebody who had to work for this app in order to be used. And we also, the Social Democrats, are in favor of good wages for good jobs as well. I think this is a very good example about this, when we say, because it was already this criticism that perhaps data or privacy protection makes too much effort or takes too much work to be implemented. But we have to think about what happens actually in the digital world. Medical data are saved somewhere. It is a matter of course that the doctor will have a door and closing the door when talking to the patient in the surgery. This is a matter of course, but we also have to transfer it to the data world. We need some protection. Protection costs a little money, but it has a good purpose. And it's the same thing. I go to bed at home, I will close the windows and or draw the curtains in order to protect myself. And so we should regard it in the same way. I understand this explanation, but it doesn't help me so much, because automatically I agree with these questions, because I want to use the app. And actually the rest of this, that I have a right of checking my private data, who uses them and who has them, will become very vague. So I would like to say that we would like to say something about copyright in this discussion round. I saw three requests of being heard, and so perhaps we can come back once again to the topic of copyright. I would like to give an example about this agreeing. I have an American antivirus protection program, and when the companies adapted it to the new data privacy guideline, there was the indication that the software can no longer be used. Or you agree with the data protection deadlines. And so I scrolled down to these instructions, and all the things that you don't want to have, for instance, merging data, and all these things were indicated. And nevertheless, I agreed with these kinds of use, because I wanted to need this program. So it's like an extortion. It is not possible to read 20 pages of legal text in order to say then, oh, I can't do this. Yeah, this is also a problem. Moreover, a question to the data privacy expert: is it possible, for instance, if I have printed forms and I can download them, because normally they earn a lot of money by selling this, is it possible to download this from your office website? This is my data protection declaration, for instance, for the website. For instance, if you have a website and you need a certain text in order to declare the data protection guideline compliance, so I can't offer this, because so I would enter into a competition with other companies, and this is the problem here, because this would be a problem of unallowed competition here. I can say that you can read our own data protection guidelines. So we have one example, an example that would be in this way, but you have the problem that it is not the authority that would become critical about this, but the competitors of your company. If, for instance, you get an admonishment letter from a competitor, the authority can't do anything about this because this is a civil procedure in court, and so the court will decide in a civil process about whether your declaration complies with the expectations or requirements or not. So this is nothing to do with administrative law. Okay, then. Yeah, hello.
You're on the programmer side. I'm actually on the, on the digital marketer side, because this is what I do. And funny enough, I work for a company. Yeah, and I work for a company that actually measures the patterns of sleep. So you were mentioning that, but the funny thing is, when the new regulation came, I didn't really have to change much of my procedures, because there are different philosophies of working in the digital marketing. Myself, I don't like to call it digital marketing exactly because of that, because there's this kind of mindset of the old offline marketing that is being brought to the digital with new problems arising from there, because, the thing is, digital amplifies you easily and allows you to target very specifically who you want to target. And in my case, I work on a philosophy that you could call inbound marketing, or you could call also content marketing, but some people call it permission marketing. So I was already doing a lot of the things that the new regulation was demanding us to do, so I didn't feel the change. But the thing is, although I am a marketer, if you want to call it that, I prefer digital strategist, I am also a consumer, and I'm a person. I have ethics, and that's why I comply with that kind of philosophy. And I think that instead of us putting the weight on the consumer, he has to read this, he has to comply with this, he has to understand this, we need to explain this to the consumer, I think that it should be brought upon the companies themselves. For instance, I don't know how in Germany laws work. In Portugal, I know that there are contracts that are immediately unbinding, that are illegal by nature. If, for instance, the nature of our exchange, even though we both want it, is illegal in itself. I can't contract a murder, for instance. Although both people included in the contract are interested in that. I want to contract a murder, and someone is obliged to that. But that is not a legal contract, because the object itself is illegal. So instead of us relying on this assumption that, they said yes, so
hello,
it's okay.
Liebe Fischball-Runden. Ich höre alle, dass Sie alle noch ganz fleißig diskutieren.
Yeah, I hear that you are still discussing very heavily, but we also have to stick to the time schedule. I would like to give you some more 5 minutes, and then I would like to ask you to come back to your seats.
And it's our political responsibility to change this instead of demanding of the common people that just want to work day to day and just want to check stuff on Facebook, that they have to do this kind of training to understand what data is being used for.
Can I make a break? We just got the request that we have only 5 more minutes. That's why a short answer from your side. Eine kurze Antwort noch von Ihnen. Und
please give me a short answer and 2 sentences about this topic. He addressed the right point. Yeah, this is also a task of the political system from the practical and human perspective as well, to open up discussion rounds and to organize them amongst different people. For instance, as we do it at our nerd table when we meet there, I always we do a match. So I'm the very evil hacker. I get all the data and what you as an advocate want to do against this, and so this is like we want to find a compromise by this play between the data hacker and the advocate, and I also wish the politics to get in experts who understand the source code of Facebook and who understand the ranking algorithm. You can understand it when you have a certain knowledge, and to talk together with them. It is also part of my job. I also work as an online marketeer at 50%, and one task is to carry out what will be ranked in which way at Google and Facebook, and this experience can also be exchanged. If I have some questions in the future about the legislation on European Parliament level we have to work on, I can address to you. Is it correct? Yeah, of course you can. Yeah, I mean it on earnest. I can go to you, because between lobbyists and experts there is a big difference. So I set great store by the fact that my company is not organized in any professional organization. We are not lobbying, because we represent a completely contrary opinion, and we can exchange our contact data after this. And I will say it to my people today, so that you have the opportunity of asking me about these things. I would like to transfer to our last topic, the guideline on privacy protection, because the copyright guideline, because this is currently under discussion. I don't know if there is also such intense discussion about this or controversial discussion. I would like to ask Melanie to explain us in brief what is the current state of discussions here. The current state of treatment is that you made a lot of fuss, and that only in March we will elect or vote for this, when everybody took to the streets who wanted to do this. But as far as the contents is concerned, I can't say so much about this. But I would like to focus on two points. You should also address three different points when talking about copyright. I don't want to talk about the performance works protection guidelines, but we can say that we have found good regulations on the different items, which allow the freelance artists and also the union representatives of them, for instance, providing them transparency rights that the artists can see how the works are used by others. And for instance, if they have combined a certain amount of money for a certain artist's works, there is still the possibility of renegotiating this price in favor of the artist. And there is also another point, that is alternative arbitration. This is also a very good thing. But I think that what is interesting to everybody is are the filters. We, as the political advisors, we are not in the first row by talking this, and we tell the parliamentary people not to do this or to do it in a different way. But I can say that I feel that I have a very hard work to be done on the 2nd of March. If we want to say this is a good, this is an evil thing, it's very difficult. Here you can choose between two different evils of the same kind. So we, as the Social Democrats, are in favor of a good payment for the artists, but we have to say as well that as the 13th Amendment is concerned, and they did a lot of work, they did a very good job in order to avoid such words that irritate. Only here I can say that only filters will make it work. So we have to make a difference between filters, that mean between the right of ownership or the right of freedom. There must be some compromise here, because we have to make sure that neither the copyright is infringed or perhaps the freedom is not infringed. But we need such filters. The user, for instance, who loads up the content will be responsible for this. Then the owner of the rights can see that, for instance, something has been uploaded where no license has been given to, and the platform can be addressed, and they have to remove such unlicensed upload. But it doesn't avoid that it is re-uploaded once again 3 days later. But I don't want to talk about my own opinion as a political advisor. We have our own opinion, but it is not the question. So we can say that currently, when platform filters are used, there is an exemption for some points, but this exception is not so far in order to accept certain platforms from this. Those who have to buy filters, because such platforms that have been on the market for 3 years at least and have a certain number of users are obliged to install such filters, and they have to buy the filters. Where will they buy the filters? They will buy it from the big platforms. I don't want to name their names. So I think that blue is a quite dominant color in the logo, and they already have these filters, and these are the platforms they should have been regulated by this, and instead of this they will earn much more money, because the filters have to be bought by the smaller ones, and the filters, they cost millions of euros, and these filters are not able to make slight differences if you talk about a certain point, and in the background there is the sound of a music which has a copyright, and in such a case then your upload will be removed from the platform, but you only wanted to give your political speech, and so here the freedom of speech is concerned. So it is a very difficult question. I wish you a lot of fun when taking this about this, but I wanted to incite you to explain this, because these 5 minutes are over now, but if you have some more time, I wanted to open up the discussion in order to talk about these things that we as the Social Democrats wanted to bring forward or wanted to do on parliamentary level. I said expressly that we as the Social Democrats wanted to do is because our parliamentary group is also divided in some extension, because our other European partners are of a completely different opinion with regard to this. We also, when we did the first voting on parliamentary level, we voted against Article 13, because for us the freedom of speech was more important than protecting these copyrights, and this would be a opportunity or a danger of introducing censorship by implementing this, and also the exceptions do not provide the required alternative for this, and so we would cut off the existence for these smaller platforms, because no people working on regional level could afford buying the upload filters, because otherwise it would cost so much money that he could liquidate his company. And so we wanted to try to use the result in a way as to find an alternative. The 5 minutes are over now, and so I would like to ask you to come back to your seats, because it's perhaps quite hard for you, because you are quite in a very interesting phase of your discussion and it's very exciting for you, but nevertheless, because the time is over, I would like to ask you to come back in order to have our conclusions. I see B group is very disciplined. They came back. I also heard a very intense discussion there, and I'm very excited to hear about your results, about your conclusions. Living working world group is still in discussion. You are very eager in your work, but I would like to ask you, please come back that we can continue our overall program, please. There is an applause in the data privacy discussion round. I know that this is a wide topic where a lot of things can be discussed, but I would like to say you that at the end of this meeting you can also discuss in private talks with the different people and experts, and I see that the Consumer Protection Discussion Group also found their conclusion, and I would like to ask you, please come back, turn back to your seats in order to follow the conclusion program. Thank you. data protection group or data privacy group discussion group, please would like to ask you to come back because we have to stick to the timetable. Mrs. Krehl, please come back and follow our final discussion round. But this promises a lot of interesting things when discussions are going on so vivid. Then it should be the case that many different new aspects could be discussed. And perhaps I should ask those who have already returned to their seats, who of you are less afraid of digitalization now after this discussion? Please show your hand. Are you, perhaps, or nobody, who now is more afraid of digitalization now after the discussion? Please show your hand. Okay. And who has positive and negative impressions with regard to the future development, and who heard things that are a little bit difficult for them for the future? Oh, thank you for your response, for your feedback. It was the one sociology student who participated. No, it was a social democrat member of the parliament, because she was in solidarity with me, because I had to bridge this gap between the two parts of the meeting. Is the discussion continuing over there in the data privacy discussion group? Please come over. We would like, please join in. Mr. Schurich, dear discussing people, I have to turn you back to our results round. We are very excited about the results, about what you have collected, and I hope that everybody who has already come here are prepared to take part in this discussion, and we can work together as we are present here and can exchange our opinions, and I'm glad about this. So everybody is returning, and now I would like to start with the evaluations of the results. We said before that there will be one representative of each discussion group giving a short overview, a brief overview of the discussion the group had before. And so I would like to suggest starting with Group A, Working World. And I would like to ask Joachim Schuster to come to the stage. He is from the European Parliament. Oh my God.
Maybe you can give him a round of applause. It's a long way to travel to the catwalk, but I'm sure he'll accomplish it and he'll be able to share the results of his session with us regarding the future world of work. Thank you very much. Could be expected, we were not able to resolve all the issues. We just started discussions on certain fields of action, because what you mentioned as a question was not really a question we focused on. So there was not really the question of whether there's a lot of fear of digitalization. It was more that this is a task we need to shape and design. And of course, we only had limited time, so we discussed three fields. First of all, what you about employees' rights and workplace representation, how this needs to be adjusted to the new world of work, and that with regard to outsourcing, you need to check in how far that is actually sensible, and whether a permit can be granted for that, and then in how far the rights are safeguarded for those working in the outsourced fields. That was one element of the decision, though we have to say that the difficulty was touched upon, and I think there is a lot of need of political action, that often this type of outsourcing is that formally there is the pretense that these are all self-employed people who have no or very little employee rights, and we need to make sure that we check this, that this is actually the case. And the second point that was made was also in the sense of opportunities, was that digitalization also leads to new forms of work, such as the home office, which on the one side certainly is an opportunity, but Again, there are work activities that cannot be done at a home office. There is certain work where presence at a workplace is required. And because we also discussed this for the public sector, there are also data protection legislation restrictions. So you can't have personal files or social security files on a server and then use them from a home office. So there are certainly data protection restrictions with regard to that, and we certainly need to look into what can be done for these new types of work. And another aspect that ties into that is the question of how can protection rights be implemented here. Certain positive change can be implemented, a right to be offline, so you don't have to be online all the time. Or one question that was recently examined in a study is, how about equal opportunities? Home office usually means that women often use their home office so they can look after their children and work, whereas men, according to the results of that study at least, often use that to promote their career by working even more, and secondly, not taking care of other aspects as well and trying to promote their career in this way. The third big field that was discussed in various aspects was that was the obvious question of digitalization leading to or requiring more education, further training, starting in schools. But then one essential aspect is, how can we do that for fields in the world of work, namely on the job training and qualification? And what do we do with people who lose their jobs because of digitalization? So what can be done to help them in terms of further training and further qualification to give these people also an opportunity to move into a new field of work or to a new company? Even though this led to the discussion of in how far could this perhaps be done based on a fundamentally different perception of work and income. Also the discussion regarding a basic income for everyone was touched upon, and that leads to the question of political design being required. How do we deal with the different opportunities that small and medium-sized companies on the one hand and large-scale operations on the other hand have? So small and medium-sized companies often train young people who then move to the large corporations because the large corporations offer them more favorable job opportunities. So the question is, how can we create more attractive jobs at small and medium-sized companies? And then another question is, how can small and medium-sized companies be supported to make sure they provide the qualification services that are necessary? Because we often the question of the restriction of financial resources often plays a role in this. In small companies, you can't provide all the qualifications that could possibly be required. So the question was whether perhaps we should create opportunities for them to make qualification more natural throughout the working life of the employees. Maybe that much as a brief overview of the discussion in session one. Thank you very much. So it's probably always hardest to be the first on stage. So a round of applause for Joachim Schuster and the World of Work session, which said, yes, there are opportunities such as a home office, but you also need to be able to switch off that home office. And then you also need to make sure that you offer the right further training and digital further training for this. And now I'm looking forward to the results of Group B that actually looked at networking and artificial intelligence. Mr. Dietjen is just making his way to the stage. And we're enjoying and savoring this moment of silence before he takes the stage in storm. Applause for round B. Well, we're not going to be quiet for a long time. So thank you, Francisca. We certainly had a fascinating discussion too. We touched upon a number of subjects that we feel are very important, and I can only highlight some of them. And the headline for our discussion was, how can we ensure that companies are ready for networking and artificial intelligence And yes, the first aspect was, yes, we talked about the development in the field of medical technology, and that's when we first noticed what it takes, namely infrastructure, and that we in Germany clearly need to make improvements in that respect. I think that is where the state needs to become more involved. It's not sufficient to just talk about e-government and then we leave it to the market to create the structures necessary for that. We need an infrastructure that is provided to make sure that all the companies can place their digital offers on them and digitalize and organize their offers accordingly. That is certainly a very central aspect. When we talk about how to get companies ready, that is not necessarily up to the companies if they haven't got access to the infrastructures that they need. So this is one point where government institutions need to become more involved to ensure that this finally happens, so we don't end up in a situation where the US won the first half time, the Chinese win the second half time, and we maybe try to somehow muddle our way through in the third half time of that game. So we need to have concepts that help us to make progress on this. Another important aspect of our discussion was, and that ties into what Joachim Schuster said, was the question of how do digitalization and IT processes get supported, how are they promoted? And one central aspect in this is that the employees actually become involved. They are employees that are actively involved and also contribute to the discussion and can contribute to the discussion within the company. And so participation needs to be arranged in these processes and in designing these processes. For example, municipal administrations, when it comes to creating an effective public administration that provides everything that we as citizens expect and need. And then the experts are those who are already working at the administrations and want to become involved in this process and want to help to shape this process when it comes to networking, promoting networking and the use of artificial intelligence. One point that I definitely want to mention is that, of course, there is the risk that know-how might be lost. If you have algorithms, then you might have consultancies coming in that want to advise the company and offer a corresponding product. But you need to make sure that by involving the employees, you stay ahead in this game. And maybe at the one or the other point, we can also take a look at the situation as is, so we don't reinvent the wheel for a couple of times. Maybe we can look at the Asian countries have, so we can get improvements of things that have already been developed elsewhere. We've seen that with Japan, then with China. Maybe next time around, China could take on this role, basically not reinventing the systems that they are, but using them more intelligently than others do. Thank you very much, Mr. Detjen. And of course, the entire round B, networking and artificial intelligence. We've already heard that we need the expansion of infrastructure, which has already begun, as we've heard, but we also need to catch up. Are there three half times? That was my question. So we need to get, Mr. Detjen, we need to catch up in the third half time, as he said, and we need to support companies in that process, be it through public administration or consultancy. It is certainly a fascinating process, and we need to make more progress, and also in the program for today. And that's why I'd now like to call out Group C with Mr. Lell talking about consumer protection. Thank you very much. In our group, we base the discussion on what the European Union has achieved in the current legislative period regarding digitalization, consumer protection, and there were a few achievements, transparency requirements in the framework of the Omnibus Directive, then security requirements that will become mandatory. But we also said all of that is not sufficient, especially with regard to the platforms. We need to develop further developments that go beyond transparency, that actually tell users that these are mandatory requirements for a platform offering to make sure that it fulfills the function of giving consumers orientation, things such as rankings that are often bought these days, then poor provisions against fake evaluations, fake shops on Amazon Marketplace. There are lots of things where platforms actually should take over more responsibility. And then there are also lots of other topics that were mentioned that were more in the direction of competitive framework conditions, portability, interoperability of platforms. That is certainly also an important subject where we used to have, where there wasn't really any difference between services. If you make a phone call, that is much clearer than using WhatsApp services, because if you have that, then you can only call others that also have that service. It's difficult, so it would be better if there is some level of interoperability, but we've learned that with a view to data protection, that might be a problem, because that would mean that data could also be forwarded to yet another corporate group. But the problem of the ever-increasing monopolies of the platforms is certainly a problem that my group has looked into. And then there was the question of, should payment in money be something that should be offered as a mandatory option for those services, so you as a consumer can choose whether you want to pay for a service with your data or in funds. And then we talked about the life cycle of products, that this is generally speaking not long enough, and the obligation to provide updates is certainly nice to have, but you don't really know how long will you get those updates, and this is something that should be provided for as long as the device is used. And if you discontinue the updates before that, that is certainly less than optimal. And then we also looked at security with a view to the aspect of whether the consumer can decide whether to install updates or not, or should there be a default option. So if you don't do anything, then the update is installed so that your product does not become a security risk for others. But again, this is something that has not been fully discussed and explored, and ultimately we didn't really arrive at a conclusion regarding future questions that we will certainly face because of digital assistants that do much more than the current platforms, that take the decision away from you. You delegate the decision as to what you want to consume fully to the platform, which does that for you. And that will have serious consequences for autonomy and maybe for the functioning of the economy, which is actually based on the interaction between supply and demand. If that demand no longer comes from persons but from the platform, that might make the situation more difficult. And besides, the scoring that might be based on all the personal data that are collected, that also raised difficult questions that we were unfortunately not really able to resolve. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Mr. Lell, from the Consumer Protection Agency, representative of session D, fake rankings, how to combat that, and then also updates. What happens if my mobile phone no longer gets any updates after only 2 years? And what happens to digital assistants that control purchasing decisions? These were the aspects discussed in this group, which is certainly fascinating. And now we'll come to the last group. I've seen really very last participants in the discussion were still sitting there a minute ago, but they've now come back, and I'm really interested in finding out what that fascinating discussion was all about from Constanze Krehl. Well, thank you very much. I have to admit, we only had two subjects that we were able to discuss, and we didn't even finish that discussion. That was, on the one hand, data protection, general data protection regulation that we discussed, and on the other hand, the copyright protection regulation. So, by the way, this is something that we also discussed. Why do these laws have to have those very, very boring names that are so very difficult to pronounce? Well, just in passing. But we've come to the conclusion following 1 year. I really can pronounce it anymore, it seems. So it's the General Data Protection Regulation. Was that... General Data Protection Regulation. It's a regulation anyway. So it actually was adopted in 2016, then had a transition period, and ultimately took effect on 25th May 2018. Quite surprisingly, in Germany, I was attacked. My colleagues were attacked. We were shouted at. Brussels was shouted at. Data protection officers and representatives were shouted at. After almost 1 year, everyone is saying it works and this is a good thing, but we do get those remarks about what else is needed. And our working group definitely said that we need media training. The young girls or boys do not have to be fully trained in how to be using smartphones or Instagram. They are all much more familiar with that than we are, or political representatives or data protection officers are. But that doesn't really give you media competence as such if you know how to operate a device. So we want device not only to be operated, we want to have people to have competences in dealing with media, in deciding where to give data, knowing what algorithms exist, how can they be used, why do I need to provide data in addition if I have an app, and what's the background to that, and how do I decide what I want to do. And these were questions that we discussed in our round, and that also revolves around education. The second aspect was also very interesting. That was the aspect of whether we need further rules. Some people feel, yes, we urgently need more rules, and others feel, no, we don't really need even more rules because that will only add to bureaucracy. I believe in the next legislature at the European Parliament we'll have to resign ourselves that there will be further rules, but we'll need to be very careful in designing these to make sure that this doesn't blow up into bureaucratic monstrosities, but they need to be easy to understand, they need to be transparent. And thirdly, both companies and platforms, as well as the users and consumers, the citizens ultimately need to be able to understand these and use them as a result. Then within our group, we also had the very urgent request that we already are in a digital society today. We felt that we need an ethics discussion within that digital society. And it was kind of unfortunate that Daniela Kolbe couldn't make it today. She's the chairwoman of that ethics committee at the German Parliament. But Definitely an important point that we made, that this needs to be taken very seriously, because we might just be able to get platforms or companies to do things on a voluntary basis, because that might become more profitable for them at the end of the day, but it also enables them to deal with the complex topics in more detail than has been the case so far. And on that note, I'd like to transfer to the heated debate we had at the last, during the last 5 minutes, after being told that we only had five more minutes, we were only able to touch on that very briefly, namely copyright regulation. And it's certainly not a secret that this is a very contentious topic within our parliamentary group as well. At the next plenary meeting in late March in Strasbourg, we will vote on that. The result of the negotiations of the European Parliament with the member states. And to be quite brief about this, the internet needs rules. And if people want to work and have to work on a creative basis, then they need to be paid for that adequately, and their rights need to be safeguarded. And there is no question about that whatsoever. And our parliamentary group fully supports that. The party members support this without doubt. The only point of discussion which is very heated in Germany, not only in Germany though, is Article 13. Upload filters is the key word here. And as a matter of fact, we as the SPD representatives, not necessarily as members of the parliamentary group, decided that in voting on that regulation, we would try to open the opportunity to open the results of the trilogue negotiations for amendments. We indeed are of the opinion that in weighing all the results, upload filters that are not allegedly not really in the wording of the text, but they are implied, are not adequate in dealing with copyright. And they are not adequate because the internet, because it would ruin the internet as we know it, also with the exception that is now included with small and medium-sized companies and smaller platforms that are less than 3 years old and have less than 10 million euros in sales. Even with that exception, we would really break lots of those companies. And what's even worse, we would introduce an option for censorship, and that is a right of freedom we want to preserve. The freedom of opinion on the internet is not something that should be risked with upload filters, and for that reason we will propose that this be opened again for amendments. We will propose that Article 13 be deleted. If we do not get a majority for that in the Parliament, then we will at least try to revise the content of this Article 13 by suggesting alternatives to upload filters and perhaps looking at the exceptions again, significantly expanding them. This is something that in those 5 minutes you gave us, we were not able to finally discuss. But perhaps I can take the liberty of saying at this point that I'm absolutely thrilled that so many young people are again looking into politics, dealing with politics. And I think this is also a word of thank you to the young people who have told us in a very fair manner what they want and what they think about this, and hence they gave us an opportunity to actually to engage in dialogue with them, and I would like to say thank you to them for that. And this is something that is not part of the subject here. I would also like to say thank you to those young people who take time off from school on Fridays, take to the streets, actually show their commitment to make sure that the somewhat older politicians start doing something about climate change, to stop climate change, and to establish a framework for the companies to actually become involved in this to stop climate change. And I think it was a very German and very bureaucratic that the first response from many politicians was you would have to punish them for doing that because going to a demonstration during school time is not permitted. I expressly like that. I think it's a good idea that they're showing their commitment, and I hope that this is something we will see again in future with regard to other subjects. Thank you very much.
And I would like to thank Constanze Gehl and the discussion round of data privacy for their presentation. We can say that this is a wide field. Fontane also lived in Leipzig in 1941. He was here to the pharmacy. He was a help hand in the pharmacy. It was not necessary to him at that time to deal with home office and artificial intelligence, but for us it's important to do this because it concerns us here directly. And I'm very pleased that we managed it to have such a good crowd intelligence and to discuss about these topics in the Fishbowls workshops. And so we had a good overlook of all the different results. Now let's talk about our next speaker. She is a woman with a lot of tasks, but she also took the time to come here. We would like to welcome very warmly the Federal Minister of Consumer Protection, Katharina Barley. Welcome. Hello. Thank you very much for this invitation. Good thing that so many of you have come here. Interested people, people of all ages came here and deal with this topic that is very interesting. I have been to Berlin this morning. We had plenary discussions, and I also went to Alice for Future for a short trip, and I talked with the young people there. It was very exciting and very motivated young people who asked the right questions. And I also share your opinion that we can be very pleased that there are these young people, hashtag, and that they fight for their own fates, for their own future. And the second topic, which was mentioned, Constanze already explained, you know that I'm also dealing with these topics. We have different roles that we have to fulfill, different possibilities of what we can do, because the things that you can do on federal government level is something that we want to try in before to change the text in a certain way. And I also, this is also our task to negotiate about these questions before the final voting takes place. And also we tried finally to remove this Article 13 or by trying to change it, because here it is also important to provide a good income for the freelance artists, but without such technical guideline as far as the filters are concerned. This doesn't work, but at the end the European Council can only decide between yes or no, between adapting or not, and we support you in every aspect in this field. I only want to mention one more item. Generally, I don't do this, but it is important for me because we talked about censorship. We have to take care here. As far as censorship is concerned, means that the state tries to directly suppress certain opinions, but it is not the thing that takes place there. I also think that upload filters are very bad things, but censorship is a notion or a concept meaning are having a different meaning and also triggering different opinions. For instance, if somebody, a government, says that they don't want to have a certain opinion and don't want to hear it, and this is like a trigger for people that are not our friends. So this is what I wanted to talk about this. Otherwise, I would like to say that I've got the impression that everything that is important to me, and I also discussed with my peer, was also addressed in your work groups. I was asked to say something about development and the outcome, the perspectives. You also talked about the chances of this development and who will be multiplied in the digital world and also influence our daily life. I don't know who of you has an Alexa on his table in the sitting room. I'm not one of these people, but perhaps some people like ordering a pizza, saying only one word or a short sentence, but it is much more than this. There are also fridges that find out, for instance, that the products are out and on their own order or reorder the products, and perhaps there's also some automatic system bringing the products at home. There are a lot of new possibilities to have more support at home. And moreover, it is also about artificial intelligence. This kind of technology will also facilitate but also change our lives in a certain way. This concerns the nursing robots, the private homes, autonomous driving. You all know these examples. There are also much more applications in the working environment, and we cannot yet imagine the whole scope of these developments. But there are also risks and challenges that are connected with these developments, and they have also been discussed and also address my core area I have to deal with, consumer protection. And yesterday we opened up an exhibition which is called The Open Codes. It's about how digitalization can categorize us as human beings, and this is an arts work. Different artists made different exhibitions or exhibits, and they showed how such could happen. For instance, if you find you as a person represented by a pure number code or so, and how you feel, for instance, in which way the computer categorizes you, and I can recommend you this exhibition. And another point that we noticed is that algorithms have been accompanying us for quite a long time, also in past times. For instance, the SCHUFA, the National Inquiry Agency on Debts and Credits, is also something that has accompanied us for years. But now we are in the age of the self-learning algorithms, so that the people that set up the algorithms do not know any longer what they actually do. And this also has some problems with regard to transparency and control or monitoring. So this brings us a lot of challenges in the field of consumer protection. For instance, which data can be allowed to be collected? Who is entitled to have the data, who is entitled to forward these data? And one of the most important question is the interconnection of different kind of data, the setting up of personality profiles and such things. And this involves some other point which was discussed in work group 2, the development of monopolies of for instance, the question if Amazon or Google in the fields of health insurance want to open up for them a market, and they collect very important health data in order to do the business, because we know that Facebook and WhatsApp and Instagram are interconnected with each other. It is quite a bad thing. But when you now start also to give those big industrial groups completely different types of data, such as health data, that and allow them to accumulate even these data, and they can be connected with the other data, we step by step get into a situation that there will be some big industrial groups knowing too much about us or know us better than we do. And how can we deal with these problems or issues? I'm pleased that Constanze said a lot about the data privacy guideline. I sometimes said that I feel like a Jeanne d'Arc of this regulation, because she told about all this regulation, but this regulation has already been in effect, and only when it actually started, everybody noticed that now it is the time when they have to implement this, and that's why there was a lot of outcry about this. So I also thought that this is quite a milestone for consumers, but this can be labeled in a completely different way by people that want to change the content about this. I have been to a meeting about the analytic scandal, and when the month of May arrives, I said, we as consumers have a very good tool, a very efficient tool, and everybody told me, oh, that's great, I'm looking forward to this new guideline. And then we had 2 weeks before this time lapsed, and there was a lot of fuss, and everybody, when we talked about this word, everybody is quite reluctant about this, and people who do not have any homepage, who don't have any business, have nothing to do with it, but they know exactly how bad it is. So and show how a big bureaucracy is that is produced in Brussels. So this is the opinion of the people. And so I think it's good that you mentioned all these issues. And I think that what we need at the end of the day is that we need the power in the hands of those who are actually concerned by the data, because if we give it out of our hands, other people will do a lot of things we can't control. They earn money with it, but are a big difference to what is actually in our interest. And so we would also we still are working on the privacy acts. I'm not directly responsible for these topics because please send the complaints to Mr. Seehofer and the privacy complaints to Mr. Altmaier. These are the two politicians directly responsible for this, but what I directly understood is the control of algorithm. I just talked about this. There are algorithms that learn on their own. So it is not possible to introduce a technical control body for algorithms to give them a certification mark. This is not possible because the algorithms are in continuous change and they influence our lives. As soon as we use a smartphone or a tablet or use a computer, as soon as we start to book a travel on the internet or to apply for a loan or something like this, we will find out that we are treated differently. And this is, can also happen to individual persons. Whether you have a Samsung or iPhone, a smartphone, it may make a difference. Or if you use your iPad or your smartphone, because the algorithms understood that when you have the handy in your hand and use it, you are in a hurry and want to be prepared to agree very quickly, for instance, to book something like a travel or so. And they know if I take my mobile phone and want to look for a flight, I will pay every price because I'm in a hurry. And if you are at home and book a flight from the PC at home, they know that you are at home, are in a calm situation, you have the opportunity of comparing this, and so there a different price will applied by the algorithms. And this is important here. The topics of transparency and control play a very big role, but we are still in the infancy of this development. We have not yet developed such checks for algorithms. Moreover, if, for instance, a new device is launched on the market, there is not yet any such check or inspection. We wanted to submit a draft for this, and we also want to install a control body who will be able to carry out such inspections. And every human being, every man should have the right to have an algorithm checked. It is not possible to decipher all these bits and bytes, but we should be in have the right, for instance, if a loan is not granted to me or somebody else's gets some I wanted to order at the internet, I must be entitled to ask for why I have not been in this favored position. For instance, I live in the wrong part of the town, or I live next to other people that have a lot of debts, or if my first name is perhaps seldom or is in a certain way unusual, or perhaps this entry in the inquiry office about credits and loans was wrong about me also. So that means every time I'm concerned by such problems, I should be entitled to ask for why I have been categorized in this way. And the second aspect from my point of view is there must be an instance, a body, control body, where the companies have to submit or disclose the complete algorithm to them. Because as far as consumer protection is concerned, there is an instrument which is called Market Watch. And if there are consumers that find that there is something wrong with the product, about finance services or health services, this market watch group can check it and find out if there is exactly something wrong, because these algorithms are about to influence our life to a considerable extent. The third point, which has not yet been addressed very much in the public way, it is the anonymity. The making data anonymous. So artificial intelligence also needs a lot of data. And everybody says that you can get these data as soon as they have been anonymized. But there are not yet any standardized procedures how this can be done in a safe way, especially for health data. This is a question of existence of the people. If we give such data to somebody else, it must be made sure that there is no way to derive the person that it actually that is actually concerned by this data. That's why we need good standards for this anonymizing services. And what we are doing now is that we have been doing research in order to find out if there are already companies that use very responsible approaches or are very transparent or use only the data they actually need. And so we looked for such companies and we found six of them where we thought that they do it in a very good way, and invited them to come into the ministry and ask them to start a program like corporate social responsibility. What we already know in the companies that is already implemented a self-commitment to act on a sustainable way could also be done in the digital world. And so to give the companies to say on their own that I want, for instance, to have a data sensitive to be a data sensitive company, and I want to get certified on this basis. When it became known, many companies showed their interest, and so we will open up the next stage of this process and open this for more companies and have worked out the first draft for this. And I think this is a very good process, because I'm very convinced that this protection of the data is an advantage of an industrial or an economic side, and this is what the consumers want to know, want to have. If they get a product or give their data, they will be treated in a very careful way. And the other point is the design in values. That means if you design products, you should, as soon as this design stage starts, to look for ethical values. Moreover, it could also be values that are prescribed by legal regulations. And we also have set up a program which is also accompanied by our ministry. And at the end of this year, the results they got will be presented to the general public. And here it is about, I would like to say something, a final remark, so I come back to the European level. We have to be aware of the fact that when talking about data, we don't have the same values when we compare different countries of the world. When looking at the United States, data first serve for earning money. What is everybody, everything is subject to this, and every other thing will be subject to this. When we have a look at China, data there are used in the first line to check or control their own population. When looking at Russia, so I don't want to name it explicitly, they use also have preferred uses of the data. But we can say that Europe and the European Union, we are the only relevant system here in the world, saying clearly that for us, data protection is about personal freedom, is about protection of the personality, of intimacy, and of self-determination. And because this is like this, Europe is quite the right place to discuss all these topics and to find new solutions. I would like to come back to this regulation about privacy we introduced. This is something that doesn't exist a second time in the world. This is the only one that exists, and it aroused so much interest in the world. There are, in the meantime, 75 countries who want to base their own model or their own data regulation on the basis of our regulation. For instance, California is one of these countries. This is like the mother state of the Silicon Valley. They also want to use it as a role model. That's why data protection for me is a very important example for what can be made if we are united in Europe and if we manage to establish regulations that are based on values and we can agree about them. And if we manage to do this, and if we can make this Europe so strong and keep it strong that we can implement these values throughout different countries, we cannot only change the life of people living in the European Union, but also we can contribute to introducing these values in other countries of the world. And I think this is something that we should wish. Thank you very much.
And I'd like to thank Katharina Bali. Perhaps you can stay here for a minute. You were asked to join us for the next item on the agenda. The Together Project was set up in 2016 to involve the citizens more in the debates of the European Union, whether it's on data protection, deletion, algorithm, or different discussions altogether. So in the framework of that, we looked at subjects that people are interested in, and people who showed that interest were Together ambassadors, and we have two here, João Barbosa and Adelina Dabo, and they will be introduced by Udo Bullmann. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. Perhaps I can say one sentence on the performance of our friend Katharina Bali. Katharina has not only proven that she's an excellent lawyer, she's also proven that she can apply her knowledge in practical politics, and she's shown you and us that in this very simple yet impressive language, we can talk about these difficult subjects. Thank you very much for that, Katharina. It has impressed all of us, and we can actually now confirm that you can learn something at social democratic events. So if you happen to want to book a flight, make sure that you do it with a glass of red wine or a cup of coffee rather in your hand rather than your mobile phone, because it could save you a lot of money at the end of the day. We would now like to introduce two young people who are new to this stage, but there have been more than 30 predecessors. We call them ambassadors of our Together concept. Now, why do we do that? We do that because our program needs people to support us, needs to do what we've done before. It's a program that aims at dialogue with the population and interest in Europe, enjoyment of Europe. And today we have two new friends that we can welcome who are joining us in that transition. Adelina Dabu, welcome to the stage. Welcome to the Together Project. She is a young journalist from Bucharest who has a lot of experience in spite of her young age, and within the corporate cooperation and communication, she has a field of expertise, an important field as we've seen today, because we need the initiative of companies in order to implement our political objectives, in order to maintain our value-based orientation in dealing with digitalization. Welcome. We're looking forward to having you on our team. And at the same time, we would also like to welcome João Barbosa. João comes from Portugal. And he also has experience in a similar field of work. He's a communications expert, and he also wants to contribute his energy to our objectives. A very warm welcome to our group. I hope you enjoy the work. Best wishes for the work. I'd now like to ask you to address us, and you can start.
Thank you very much. I will just give this up. I will take the chance to address you in English. I hope this is fine, but unfortunately I do not speak German. Thank you for the opportunity to be here. As it was mentioned already before, today tens of thousands of people, of students, of young people, have marched over climate change. Also today in Romania, other tens of thousands of people have stopped work for 15 minutes together with their employers to strike over highways. They were expecting for decades. So maybe we can say there is nothing these two objectives have in common. Maybe they seem opposite because climate change does not necessarily works well with traffic. But in the same time, we can see that there are people who are actually going offline from their after their online activities to fight their fate. They want to take the power into their hands and change their future. This is the main feature. And I think this is a moment when politicians should look closer and actually use their power to empower these people. It's the time that the politicians give more of their own power to these people who have gathered online and now they are making their voice heard offline as well. And I think in the empowerment process, a digitalization is indispensable. So basically, we have technology, but its future is not known yet. It's yet to be shaped, and its effects are not neutral, but will actually be well linked to the complexity of the social life we are facing nowadays. I think technology alone is merely a tool, and what matters is the value we are putting into it. And I rest assured that at European level, we have agreed already on the values we are supporting. And now we only need to put them better at work in the interest of the people we are serving as politicians. I mean you, because I am more of a citizen. We are aligned on these values, and what we need to do more is to support those fights, both online and offline, that are fought for value-based causes, not at European level, but mostly during this time in the member states. So this is what we are calling for you to support the people who are fighting for European values at home. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Adelina Dabu, for this statement from Romania, from you as a person, and to my right side, an meiner rechten Seite.
On my right side, we have João, and João has also prepared a short statement to explain his views to it.
good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank the S&D group to give me the opportunity for finally walking in a catwalk. It's making me feel like a model. But anyway, what brought us together here, it's obviously digitalization, and there's a lot of topics that we could cover here, and the time is always short because everything is so complex. But I, from the conversations that I had with people, I had really good insights that, people gave me, and very thought-provoking moments. And I'd like to give you one as well for you to take home, and probably in the next meeting this could have a panel of itself. As you are aware, well, me being a digital strategist, I know how a small brand can easily get expanded on the digital context. You don't really need to have a really big infrastructure to achieve goals worldwide. And what I can gather from the 3 years that I've been studying this is that these means are also used not only for commercial purposes, but also political purposes, and sometimes by bad actors, toxic people, far right, to be precise. And I think that one thing that I would like to, provoke you to think about is Europe creating an organ, a transnational organ, a digital task force that would have ranging responsibilities such as creating content for a digital literacy, for democracy literacy, but also finding threats online, and especially where the funding of these threats is coming from. And basically trying to improve the knowledge of lawmakers so they can create better legislation, like we have been talking here, but not only about the commerce of digitalization, but also about the civility, the citizenship of digitalization, meaning creating good laws that allows us to go after people that hack, people that dox information of, for instance, activists, people who spoof digital presences of institutions, people that are attacking the credibility of the institutions, such as the rule of law, the newspapers and the media in general. And this task force should have the inclusion of people from many, many fields, because this is a different context. We cannot just simply transpose the things that we had on the offline to the digital. Digital has its own complexity, its own dynamics. So I urge you, since you have political responsibilities, to take this thought into account, so we can start to discuss this among, like somebody said here before, not reinventing the wheel country by country, but starting a good dialogue on this subject, because although these threats are coming from within each country, they are actually all connected. They are connected. We are not. We are not having enough discussions about this. They are aligned. They know what they do. They do it well. And we come to the risk of losing the dynamics. And we have seen this happening in France. We have seen this happening in Germany. We have seen this happening in Brazil, in the United States. Everywhere, the far right is rising because they are working together. And since this is the name of this event, I hope that we can also work together in order for us to counterattack this threat, because we all believe in democracy here. And we... Thank you.
Take the microphones just with you and give it back. I just say thank you to our ambassadors. Danke an unsere Botschafterin Adelina Dabu und Joao Barbosa. Adelina, die uns erzählt hat, was...
Adelina told us about the situation in Romania, about demonstrations there. Joao pointed out to us that the abuse of social can also create dangers, such as the rise of populism, and that this can be promoted through the abuse of these systems and the distortion of facts. I think that not only because of our ambassadors, but also because of the discussions that we've had in this room by the various speakers, I've certainly gained lots of new ideas, perspectives, and insights. I have to admit that I also have a website, and it was certainly very stressful that week in May. I still remember that, but I can also tell you, looking at it from a positive ankle. I got rid of some newsletters I never read anyway. So there are always various coins to various sides to a coin. And especially when it comes to digitalization, there is certainly an abundance of opportunities. We can still help to shape that. And I think we came here today to try and shape that process, making sure it goes in the right direction. And I would like to use this opportunity to thank you and hand over the floor to our host from Leipzig. My name is Franziska Wilhelm. I really enjoyed being here today. I would like to thank all the speakers, all the organizers, and all the guests at this event, of course. And I now leave the stage for Constanze Krehl. And well, thank you very much. I'm absolutely happy that this has been such a successful event. As an absolute optimist, I see wonderful opportunities that we can realize with digitalization, not only in industries, but also in data protection, consumer rights, also as far as employment and labor is concerned. But we still have a lot of work to do here in Saxony. Even though Martin Dulich pointed out these successes today, we still have a long way to go with regard to infrastructure. We also have to do a lot of training. And until we reach our goals, we will have to do a lot at the universities, not only in terms of vocational training, also at universities training engineering, computer experts, experts that are able to basically help to shape that process from a technical perspective. And we certainly have to do a lot in this respect in Saxony, but I also know that Martin Dulich is aware of that and that he's working towards that, and I can now move on towards the tasks we're facing in Europe. Again, thank you very much for being here today. Continue to show such a high level of commitment, especially the young people. Please make sure you continue your commitment and be kind as you do that. We are certainly willing to listen to you, and we want to maintain that close contact. Thank you very much, Constanze. Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to ask you for a big round of applause for Franziska. She's been such a wonderful host today and certainly helped us through the agenda. I would like to thank Constanze for being here today, for inviting us to come here today. Leipzig is wonderful. Thank you very much for your presence here today, for your contribution in the panel, in the individual discussions, in the joint discussion forum. It's been a wonderful event, wonderful conversations and discussions, and I promise you that we will continue these. At the end of this event, I would like to make one point that I think concerns our perception as the Social Democrats in Europe. We want to design this process. We've looked at open questions resulting from modern technologies, questions for people in their immediate environment, at work, at home, with their families. And there are many questions, many concerns that are being voiced in this respect. But we are the ones who want to help you to find answers that are in line with people's need. Not the answers of the powerful, not the answers of those who are influential. No, the answers for the people. And that's why we would like to invite you to accompany us in this process, to support us in this process, to share this process. I can tell you what we are planning to do as a parliamentary group. We know about the big challenges that we are facing, so we have established a program for our group, looking at everything that we've done before in economic politics, in environmental policy, social policy, when it comes to employment. And we've made a promise within our parliamentary group. We want to look at sustainability. We take seriously what the United Nations defined as its sustainability aims for 2030. The Fridays for a Future generation has contributed its share to show how important political alternatives are And that is what we will make the center of our political efforts over the coming weeks and months, and with your support over the coming 5 years at the European Parliament. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the evening, and you're cordially invited to join us for our reception with some refreshments. We certainly enjoyed having you here and being here. Thank you. Udo, there's one sentence I'd like to add. I would like to thank you very much for being here. I hope you'll come back to Leipzig soon. It's certainly worthwhile, as you've noticed. Thank you very much for being here today. I wish you every possible success, as well as every possible success for all of us, especially in May. And I was instructed by Franziska to give out some technical information. It might be a bit boring, but please remember to leave your headsets on the chair so that they can be collected when you leave the hall. And all those who are still here and would like to have a glass of wine with us, please come to the photo sessions to have a joint photograph taken, and then we can have a glass of wine. Thank you very much.
Shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man.